My uncle called me up and said a friend of his had a recording studio and they were looking for someone to break in, an apprentice. And he asked if I'd be interested, and I said, sure. So I went over and interviewed for the job, and I got it. I got there, and the first guy I met was Tommy Dowd. And so, and he took an instant liking to me, and the two of us got along so well, and I just hung on, you know, and followed him around. And I had, he bought me a notebook, and I drew diagrams of all the setups and what mics he used. Radio Recorders at that time was considered the best studio in L.A. Capitol had just opened up a couple of years before, but Radio Recorders was where, you know, all the old timers, Bing Crosby, and everybody was recording. And I got to do a lot of stuff there, a lot of jazz and pop stuff. RCA then opened their studio in 1959 in the old NBC building on Sunset and Vine. They had two studios, and they opened them up, and they hired me. I was the first engineer they hired. You know, as a staff engineer, it was great. It was absolutely a full-time job. And I can remember days where I'd do a session. In those days, we did three-hour sessions, and we did four songs usually in 3 hours. But I can remember days when I did Ike and Tina Turner at 9 o'clock in the morning till noon. Then from 1:30 to 4:30, I did like Gogie Grant, who was a pop singer at that time. And then in the evening from 7 to 10, I would do Henry Mancini or Sam Cooke. And everything was done mono and two-track. And then we finally, you know, got onto three-track and four-track. And, you know, we had to do everything at one time, you know, and you had to balance everything. And because what you heard coming out of the speakers at that time was exactly how the record was going to sound. I remember when we had 8-track, and somebody said, what the hell are we going to do with 8-tracks? I feel sorry for engineers today, like the young guys coming in today, in the sense that they don't have the experience or don't have a chance to have the experiences that I had, or Bones Howe, or Phil Ramone, or any other great guys that were around at the time. Because we did everything. We would do country music, we would do classical music, we'd do sometimes polka music, jazz, big band, you name it. And we had a chance to do it all. A good engineer made a good record. A bad engineer usually made a bad record. And so you had to be on top of your game all the time. Back in those days, you know, there was no automation on the boards. So when you were mixing, each mix down was almost like a performance. And in some cases, like when I did, when I was working with Steely Dan on Asia, and I mixed two of the cuts in the album, Peg and Deacon Blues. There were four of us sitting at the board. You know, I was down here doing all these things, and Donald Fagen was leaning over, twisting the echo on one thing, and someone else was doing a little thing on the guitar, and every time it was a performance. It took us 12 hours to mix one song. Editing was amazing in those days, you know, because we'd take out a piece from here and put it on the wall and mark it, and, you know, the control room would have tapes all around, you know, marked what they were and how we were going to fix things, because we'd take a verse from take two and a chorus from take four and something else from take three and put it all together. I remember doing one thing with Eddie Fisher where I think Hank Sakala and I, Hank was the engineer and I was the producer, we made something like 22 edits in 8 bars. You had to edit well to be a good engineer, but a lot of guys got, I would watch guys' hands start to shake when they had to do something. Yeah, you know, you had to find the spot and mark it, cut it, and then go down and find another spot and mark it and cut it and take that out and piece it together. And that would be the master, yeah. So you couldn't screw it up. Oh, there were times when they were, and we'd be scuffling, looking for pieces, you know, on the floor, because tape would be all over. We all taught our assistants how to do what we do and broke them in. And we took pride in teaching, you know, the assistant and the younger engineers, on showing them how we did things. And you know, Armin was like that, Bones was like that, you know. We take pride in watching. All of a sudden I say, yeah, I taught that guy, and now he's one of the best engineers in the business. It's great. When rock and roll started, it changed a lot of the way we recorded rock and roll, the musicians that we used. Some guys, some drummers could make the transition pretty easily, some couldn't. Some guys didn't want to. Some of the jazz drummers, who would be Shelly Man, like, who could do anything. It was an incredible drummer, but he couldn't play on a rock and roll date. He just, not that he couldn't, he didn't want to. That was not what he was into. So I think that was it. A lot of the musicians felt that, hey, I can do this and I can make a lot of money doing this rock and roll stuff, and really got into it. When I teach in school, or I go to new classes or go to recording schools and do a little seminars, I always tell the guys that the best friend you have in the studio is the musician. If you're not sure where to put the mic, talk to the guy out there. He wants his instrument to sound the best. So he's going to say, if you put it right here, it's usually where they put it, and that's where I get the best sound. And so you've got a head start. And I know engineers that never go out and talk to the musicians. I just don't know how that happens, because the musicians are my best friends. I mean, I love hanging with them. You know, they're funny. They're interesting. I was doing Eddie Fisher, producing Eddie Fisher in the afternoon from 2 to 5. And then I would go upstairs, and I was into transcendental meditation in those days, and I would meditate. And then I would come down at 8 o'clock and do the Jefferson Airplane. And we'd go to 4 or 5 in the morning. I'd go home, get a few hours sleep, come up, go into the office, get my paperwork done and my budget stuff, and then go in to do Eddie Fisher again. So this went on for about 2 weeks. And I called my boss in New York, and his name was Ernie Altshuler, and I said, Ernie, I just can't do this anymore. He said, what do you mean? I said, look, I'm working 16, 18 hours a day. I said, you know, I'm not hardly getting much sleep. I said, you got to get somebody to do Eddie Fisher, if you know, and I'll stay and do the airplane. And he said, well, why? Truck drivers do it. So I said, truck drivers do it. What do you mean truck drivers? Well, they work all those hours. I said, well, you know what? Get yourself a couple of truck drivers. I quit. And I typed up my resignation, sent it in, finished out what I had to do, and that was it. So 2 weeks after that, the Jefferson Airplane called me on the phone, and they say, RCA said we could use an independent producer, and there isn't anybody at RCA we want to work with. So they said, yeah, we could use someone outside. Would you like to continue to do it? So I said, sure. So I went in, I signed my deal, and went in and worked the thing. My first royalty check from the Jefferson Airplane was $50,000. Doing one act as opposed to doing 10, 11 acts, I was doing Glenn Yarbrough, and I was doing a group called the Women Folk, and I was doing Sam Cooke, and I was doing Jefferson Airplane, and Eddie Fisher, and a group called the Astronauts, and a group called Liverpool Five. I mean, it was just insane. And all of a sudden, now here I am on my own. And I wasn't working near as hard. I was having a lot more fun, and I'd have more time to spend on one artist than I did on trying to do 11 artists. So it was better. Everything was coming out better, and it was great. You know what, the age is just a number. You know, it's how you feel and what's inside you. You know, I still feel like a kid, you know, when I get in there, and things still excite the hell out of me, and so it's great. I think it keeps me young, if anything. I think if I retired now, that would be it. I'd probably fall asleep and not wake up.